Let's talk about the Invertible Matrix Theorem. It's IMT for short. So this is a statement that gives a characterization of invertible matrices. So suppose I have an n by n matrix, then the following statements are equivalent, meaning they're all true or all false. The first statement is that the matrix A is invertible. Next, A is row equivalent to the n by n identity matrix. Next, A has n pivot positions. Four, the equation, the matrix equation AX equals zero has only the trivial solution. Five, the columns of the matrix A form a linearly independent set. Six, the transformation with standard matrix A, so the matrix transformation, this is T of X equals AX, is injective. Seven, the matrix equation AX equals B is consistent for every vector B in Rn, so it has at least one solution. Eight, the columns of A generate Rn, or span Rn. Nine, the matrix transformation T of X equals AX is surjective. 10, there exists a left inverse. So this is an n by n matrix C that has the property that C times A equals the identity. 11 is there exists a right inverse, an n by n matrix D that has the property that A times D equals the identity. And finally, A transpose is invertible. All right, so let me copy this over again, and I want to highlight a few things to take notice of. So first, the invertible matrix theorem is only a statement about square matrices. So you need it to be n by n. Number of rows has to equal number of columns. And if you notice, these first three statements are ones that we've already seen are equivalent when we're talking about inverses of matrices. Right? So when you want to compute the inverse of a matrix or see whether it's invertible, you row reduce and try to see if you can get to the identity matrix. That's equivalent to having n pivot positions for an n by n matrix, and that gives us an explicit way to compute the inverse when it's invertible. The next three are statements that we've shown are equivalent when we're looking at linearly independent sets and injective linear transformations. Right, so in particular, like item four, the equation AX equals zero having only the trivial solution, that's exactly the definition of the columns of A forming a linearly independent set. And I just want to notice that in item five, even if you're dealing with a general matrix, not necessarily square, the columns of the matrix are going to form a linearly independent set if and only if the matrix has a pivot in every column. So the number of pivots has to equal the number of columns. The next three statements are ones that we've looked at already when we were looking at surjective linear transformations and spaces generated by vectors. Right? And so we've already seen that the columns of a matrix generating Rn is the same as saying the transformation, the matrix transformation is surjective, and that if you just write down what that means, that gives the same thing as saying that AX equals B is consistent for all choices B. This item eight, the columns of a matrix A generating Rn, even if we're dealing with non-square matrices, this statement is true if and only if the matrix has a pivot in every row. And so you can start to see the invertible matrix theorem is playing off of the fact that the number of rows equals the number of columns. And that's going to link the purple statements, the yellow statements, and the blue statements here. All right. The next two statements are strictly weaker, or appear strictly weaker, than statement one, right? When A is invertible, by definition, that means there is a single matrix that works as a simultaneous left and right inverse. And statement 10 is saying, well, if you can find a left inverse, then that's enough. The matrix is going to be invertible. Statement 11 being equivalent to 1 is saying, if you can find a right inverse, then that's enough, and the matrix will be invertible. Finally, statement 12 is relating a matrix being invertible to its transpose being invertible. Let's take a look at a proof of why that might be true. So let's try to prove that A is invertible if and only if A transpose is invertible. So let's first just suppose that A is invertible. That tells us that there's an n by n matrix, we can call it A inverse, that has the property that A inverse is the identity, and A inverse A is the identity. And so notice, if I take the transpose of the identity matrix, I get the identity matrix back, right? And so what I'm going to do is take each of these equations and compute transposes of both sides, right? So for the first equation, I get this, and I'm noticing, I'm using the fact that the transpose of a product of matrices is the product of the transposes of the matrices, but in the opposite order. And so I get A inverse transpose times A transpose is the identity. I repeat the computation again for the other equation, A inverse A time equals the identity. Again, I'm going to use the fact that the transpose of a product is the product of the transposes in the opposite order. And I get A transpose times A inverse transpose is the identity. And so these two statements together tell me that A transpose is invertible because I found a matrix I can multiply on both sides to get the identity matrix. And since that matrix is the same, I know that A transpose is invertible and that matrix is the inverse. So A transpose inverse is A inverse transpose. And now this is an if and only if statement, and so I'd have to go back and repeat the argument. But the argument's the same. If you just swap the roles of A and A transpose in the argument above, you can prove the converse. So let's take a look at how this might be used in an example. Right, so, I mean, the basic idea is the invertible matrix theorem is a collection of statements that are logically equivalent. And so if you're asked to show one thing, it's enough to show one of the other statements, one of the easier ones. Right? So suppose you're asked, you're given this 4x4 matrix, and you're asked, is this matrix invertible? Well, one thing you can do is just notice it's already in echelon form. It has a pivot, four pivots, and so by invertible matrix theorem, the matrix is invertible. Let's take a look at another example. Let B be this 3x3 matrix. And I could ask, is B invertible? And again, you can use the invertible matrix theorem again. So if I just take the transpose of B, then I get a matrix that's in echelon form. It has three pivots. So that tells me that B transpose is invertible by the invertible matrix theorem. And then by the invertible matrix theorem, that implies B is invertible as well.